This is a HeadGum Podcast.
What's up, everybody? It's your boy, the Spoon Man. I got a little factoid for you. Did you know that traditional bed sheets can harbor more bacteria than a toilet seat? Ugh. It can lead to acne. That's, ugh is right, Wags. It can lead to acne, allergies, and stuffy noses, and it's just gross. Miracle Made offers a whole line of self-cleaning, eco-friendly bedding.
Such as sheets, pillowcases, and comforters that prevent 99% of bacteria and require three times less laundry. Using silver-infused fabrics inspired by NASA, Miracle Made sheets are thermoregulating and designed to keep you at the perfect temperature all night long, so you get better sleep every night.
These sheets are infused with silver, Wags. That prevents up to 99.7% of bacterial growth, leaving them cleaner and fresher three times longer than other sheets. No more gross odors.
Miracle sheets are luxuriously comfortable without the high price tag of other luxury brands and feel as nice, if not nicer, than bed sheets used by some five-star hotels. Stop sleeping on bacteria! Bacteria can clog your pores, causing breakouts and acne. Sleep clean with Miracle.
Wags, you know how much I trust Miracle?
How much?
I gave those sheets to my mummy to use while she visited me this week.
Wow.
That's right. Mummy and sister both used Miracle.
Wow.
That's right. So go to trymiracle.com/doughboys to try Miracle Made sheets today. And whether you're buying them for yourself or as a gift for a loved one, if you order today, you can save over 40%. And if you use our promo code Doughboys at checkout, you'll get three free towels and save an extra 20%.
Miracle is so confident in their product, it's backed with a 30-day money-back guarantee. So if you aren't 100% satisfied, you'll get a full refund. Upgrade your sleep with Miracle Made. Go to trymiracle.com/doughboys and use the code Doughboys to claim your free three-piece towel set and save over 40% off. Again, that's trymiracle.com/doughboys to treat yourself.
Thank you, Miracle Made, for sponsoring this episode.
Hey, buddy, it's Weiger. You know, I normally do a scripted intro at the top of each pod, but I have discontinued that during the WGA and SAG-AFTRA strikes, as you know if you're a regular listener. As of this recording, the studios and guild leadership are back at the negotiating table, and in the meantime, we will still be out there on the picket line, as per usual. I mentioned last week the ongoing and now expanding UAW strike. We are continuing to stand with auto workers. But I also want to highlight a lower profile labor action. There's all sorts of this stuff happening all across the country. So there's this computer hardware company, Corsair, and their workers, among their many tasks, assemble custom gaming controllers and gaming PCs. And you know me, I'm a toxic gamer, bro, so I appreciate that sort of stuff. If you've ever built your own PC, you know this is like a skill and labor intensive activity. So I have a quote here I pulled from a recent Polygon article about this. Let me read this real quick. Quote, several of Corsair's gaming computers cost more than the amount of money the person who put it together makes in 2 weeks, Madsen, who's a warehouse worker, added. You're building more than what the company believes you're worth in just half a day. Anyway, the workers at a Corsair warehouse in Duluth, Georgia, have a union election on September 28th. That will be a week from today's release, if you're listening to this episode. Release day. So solidarity with all of them. And again, you know, just encouraging to see workers asserting their power, fighting for their fair share across all sorts of different industries, food service included. Also, to borrow a Mitchism, I am glad that Bill Maher folded like laundry. Anyway, enjoy today's episode. One of our favorite guests and the restaurant. Oh, baby. This week on Doughboys, Guisados. Welcome to Doughboys, the podcast about chain restaurants. I'm Nick Weiger, along with my co-host, a proud member of SAD SHAFTRA, the Spoon Man, Mike Mitchell.
We're putting strike roasts in
this
here?
This is a strike roast. SAD SHAFTRA.
I'm sad because my shaft is small.
That's the idea. Or this is just saying it's a commentary on your shaft being sad. Like that's someone's characterization of it.
Like someone sees it and says that's sad.
Yes, that's sad.
Thanks.
Hope everyone is okay after Hillary. Also hoping the strikes end soon and both unions get a fair deal. With love and solidarity, Kevtron, roastspoonman@gmail.com. Thanks, Kevtron.
Hillary, we just did this on our last app we recorded.
We recorded two episodes today, and that previous one, And also, this is going to feel so fucking old because we're just recording on the other side of Tropical Storm Hillary, which hit the SoCal. And then by the time this comes out, it'll be like 3 weeks in the past.
I'm feeling like Bill Clinton. Hillary, bit of a letdown. It was a letdown.
I will say, I will endorse the idea of emergency preparedness, mm-hmm. even when the natural disaster does not actually live up to everyone's expectations.
And I'm going to say, to be clear, he's the one to get let down in that relationship, not her, with his actions. Just rainy. It was just rainy.
Yeah, it was a little rainy. It's fine. We're on the other side of it.
I snuck out and saw Strays. I saw the movie Strays. I snuck out and saw Strays. Like, everyone was like, stay home. I was like, I'm going to go see Strays. I saw Strays. I didn't care.
You like Strays?
You know, I laughed like 5 to 7 times.
There you go. It's better than a Doughboys episode.
That is better than a Doughboys episode. Why? Because we started up top. We were talking. We're all full of piss.
Yeah, if you're listening to this episode for the first time, I hope you like pee, because this is going to be a piss talk episode.
Me, you, and our guests all full of piss. And
we're
vinegar,
very hydrated.
We'll find out.
We'll see.
What did that mean exactly? Like, he's full of piss and vinegar. He was like vigor, ready to go at it, right?
I think so, yeah.
But
like fired up.
But what does that mean?
Can we look at the etymology?
Yeah, what does it mean?
Okay, hold on.
Like,
let me do some
like being full of piss, I'm like, okay, I guess. Mm. It makes me think of drinking, I guess. You know what I mean?
Okay, so it's a, apparently it is a, it's from John Steinbeck. His novel, In Dubious Battle. This is the quote from the novel. Listen, Mr., London said, them guys is so full of piss and vinegar, they'll skin you if you show that slick suit outside.
Mm. Okay.
Steinbeck was clearly pleased with the phrase and repeated it in 1938 in The Grapes of Wrath. Says the same sort of thing. The grandpa says he's full of piss and vinegar.
It's a good saying.
It is a good saying.
I don't really get it still.
It's a Steinbeck. Well, okay, so there is like a vim in something, vim and vigor. You've heard that one?
Mm.
So it's like, it's supposed to be like a riff on vig and vigor, which I think is like an old-timey sort of thing.
R.L. Steinbeck. That's a good Jeopardy before and after.
Like John Steinbeck and R.L. Steinbeck. Like
yeah, I guess it doesn't really work.
No,
it's
that's
not,
good.
It's not really what a Jeopardy before and after is.
It's like,
but R.L. Steinbeck seemed like something.
Yeah, this spook, like it. I'm trying to think of an R.L. Stein book, like the haunted.
I was trying to think of a John Steinbeck book. So you and I are, we're if we put our heads together,
like Night of the Living Dummy, Grapes of Wrath. Like that would be like the clue.
The Grapes of Wrath already sounds like an R.L. Stein book.
Night of the Living Grapes of Wrath.
Maybe we just add scary, the scary
Night,
grapes
the
scary of wrath.
Scary grapes of wrath. What is R.L. Steinbeck?
Or like the living grapes of wrath. Like
that's
the grapes
good.
Are alive. It's like a Killer Tomatoes sort
yes.
of thing. R.L. Steinbeck's got legs.
How about grape bumps instead of goosebumps?
Wait, what is it?
Grape bumps instead of goosebumps?
For Great Expectations?
No, grape bumps.
Oh, he didn't even write Great Expectations.
No, what are you talking about? No, that's Charles Dickens.
I knew it was Dickens. I corrected myself.
Yeah. That would be
grape,
if you...
You're saying grape bumps, like Grapes of Wrath.
That would be like if you were to be like, he was on news radio and wrote Great Expectations, Andy Dickens. That one works. who is Andy Dickens?
I think maybe R.L. Steinbeck works.
Yeah, R.L. Steinbeck does work.
Or maybe it would have to be, if it was a Jeopardy before and after, maybe it would have to be like Beck the singer. Look,
this is full piss energy. This is what you get when our bladders are full and recording a podcast. We're going to do before and after pitches.
You didn't know the song Fish and Chips and Vinegar?
No, I still don't.
So I was singing like piss and shit and vinegar, but it doesn't really. It's like singing a parody song if you don't know the original.
Yeah.
What does it mean to you? Nothing. Right. Yeah, I like that phrase, Wags. I can't believe that. Maybe that is just a very New England thing. We've talked about it multiple times.
You know what I like is a more modern version of it, young, dumb, and full of cum.
Yeah, but piss and vinegar you can say to your grandpa. And
your
you
grandpa can,
can
say, your salty grandpa can say that. Your salty grandpa is going to say young, dumb, and full of cum.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Though salty
maybe
is,
you will.
Though cum is salty, I think, in some ways.
Right.
Isn't it?
I've heard. I don't know.
Yeah, who knows what it tastes like? Do you think it would be, if we did taste test come like on the podcast, do you think it would be a point where people would like be like, that's enough?
Subscribes, like, come on, guys. Like, that's I enough. Can't believe like, you actually did that.
Do you think it would be, or do you, I mean, like, definitely some people would stick around.
Some people would stick around. Some people would really like it. And then some people would be like, that's what enough. Are you doing?
They went too far. Yeah, I think it would. On. I think people maybe would.
Well, one thing to talk about doing it, to actually do it, it's disgusting. I don't want to see that.
Yeah.
What's next? Eating your own shit? Our mouths are full of shit.
I would never do that.
I would never eat my own shit.
But if we were doing a taste test and like, a, you know, dab my finger in it, I think I could maybe do that.
A little shit?
We talked about this recently, but you didn't have any school bus songs? Because remember I told you like from east to west, us kids are the best. Remember like that's...
Yeah, I wrote the
that's
school...
Like a, that's a school bus song.
But when I wrote
most,
this...
It's usually like... I've said this.
Yeah.
It's usually like pro kids. Kids rule and like adults stink. You know what I mean?
When I rode the school bus, because I walked to elementary school. When I rode the school bus, it was in middle school and in high school.
I also walked to elementary.
Yeah, but I feel like we were past the school bus song phase in middle school and high school. I think kids are too cool for that, or thought they were too cool for that.
Okay.
Maybe like going to camp, but I don't remember any specifically.
Yeah, all right. Maybe it's a difference between the East Coast and the West Coast. Who knows?
No, I think there's school bus songs out here. I just didn't encounter them as much.
Yeah. Anyway, we're filled with piss. Here's a drop.
A Emma, piss?
This will become a drop. Emma, hit him with it, please.
So about the Reaper Spice. Wow. Destroyed whole. Destroyed whole. Destroyed whole. Destroyed whole. Stop talking about my ass. I take it back. I think people would want the cum episode.
I saw you listening to that drop and staring up as if you were seeing news that a plane has hit the first tower. It was a similar vibe where I was like, oh, all right. It seemed like you weren't enjoying yourself. You're also tired.
I'm very tired.
You've been too tired lately. Your job is podcasting. It's pathetic.
I got a picket line.
Oh, fuck off.
I got to be the picket line, like 8:45.
Me too, every day.
No, I get up early, and sometimes my body just naturally wakes up a little earlier. This is one of those days. I woke up at like 5:30.
This is your job. This is all you do.
Yeah, I know.
Don't get tired for the pod.
I'm not getting tired for the pod. I am tired, and I'm doing the pod. It's like a lot of people are when they're doing the jobs.
We need you full of the piss and vinegar. You have no vinegar.
You know what? Let's record in the morning then, Mitch. I would love to switch to a morning schedule. I'll be fucking full of piss and vinegar right then.
We can't do that to Casey. What are you, fucking crazy? Hey, everyone, heck, I'm coming at fucking 8 a.m.? That's insane. We only have 3 hours of work a week. We have to do it at 8 a.m. on a Monday?
We don't have to start at 8 a.m., but I'm saying we could do like 10 a.m.
Ugh. Still snoozing at that point. Anyway.
Who sent in the drop?
Hi there. I'm at Corey C on the Doscord.
Hi, Corey.
And here's my latest stupid drop. Love the show. Hope Nick's hole feels better soon, Corey.
That's very nice.
Yeah.
You know, we had something very spicy for this week's meal.
It
is. We'll talk about in a second.
Did it destroy your hole?
Mitch, I'll keep people in suspense on that one, but I will introduce our guest.
Wow.
From the podcast XOXO Gossip Kings, Lamar Woods is back. Hi, Lamar.
Hey, what up, what up? How y'all doing?
Thanks so much for making time for us. What a treat.
Thanks for having me back. I missed you guys. It's been so long.
I feel like we've had a lot of like new friends lately, Mitch, on the podcast. A lot of great guests, but it's like great to get one of our favorites back in here.
We're trying to run through guests, get everyone on the show who's ever wanted to come on and so that it's we've done it.
The box is checked.
It's like, finally.
We're trying to get through
it. Stop texting. We got you on.
When are you going to put me on Doughboys? That's like me with Nicole and Why Won't You Date Me? Like, why won't you put me on the podcast? He's like, I tried it. There's a consensus. No one wants to.
It's that sort of anyone who messages to be on, it's a very funny thing. I'm like, I'm always grateful. I want people to come on
it's
the
nice,
podcast.
Yeah.
But then I feel bad because, like, there's always some sort of wait list. And then, of course, you're like, Dick Dorksley needs to come on. I'm like, who the fuck is Dick Dorksley? He's actually one of the strike captain. Okay, fine. Dick Let's Dorksley. Get Dick Dorksley
oh, yeah,
on.
I saw that guy out there.
Dick Dorksley's great.
With the megaphone.
The fucking.
He won't shut his mouth. Sticking his cap down.
But, yeah, he's not captain. Are
telling me what to do out there.
Weiger is a strike captain.
It's true.
You're pretty good. Are you
a
nice?
Cool captain.
You're a cool one?
I'm a cool captain.
I just don't like being yelled at. When I was with the cone, like, I'm not, like, I'm going to walk around the cone, but sometimes I'm talking to a buddy and I miss the cone and then they go crazy.
Just
I'm
really to bad keep with things, keep the peace, to de-escalate, I think is the priority.
Yeah.
I think most people are doing that.
I'm bad with, like, the call and response. I don't know why that's, like, inherently embarrassing to me. And as a performer, like, we do embarrassing things all the time and, like, you can get yourself to a place to do that if you want to. But then when someone is like, when I say, fair, you say contract. I'm like, contract. I don't really do it that loud.
Shout it out. Shout
I'm
out.
I'm scared. I don't know why I'm scared.
Yeah.
I know what you mean, but do you feel that way in a crowd? Like in an audience?
Yeah, I think it's like a I think it's more of a crowd in an audience too. But if I'm on stage, I'll be loud and annoying or here.
Right. Yeah.
But if I'm on the line, contract. That's all I can get out of me.
Interesting.
I mean, I want the fair contract.
I don't know.
Yeah, yeah, you like, yeah, don't sound like you do.
Contract! There you go.
Contract.
Even that was, I couldn't, like, I can't.
I know what you mean. On the strike line, I have trouble with it. Like, for some reason, maybe I don't know, I'm not ready for what I have to say yet or something.
Yeah.
But I'm a fan of call and response because I'm a rapper, so I do that a lot, like on stage.
Yeah.
But I have to.
But if it's you who has to respond, are you like
I guess
it?
Yeah, I've never been in it. That was the first time, on the right strike line when I had to, like, respond. Yeah, it's not. You don't feel as much control.
I think there's like things of like it's very high, like a high school thing where I'm like afraid of like, I'm afraid of being like getting made fun of or being a dork, which I think it's cool to support to yell it out and support it. But also I don't know if it's like a Catholic thing of like don't yell or I don't know what the fuck it is. I'm just telling you that I am embarrassed by it when it.
Yeah, you're fine.
All right, fine. I'm gonna do it. Next time, I'm gonna yell.
Yeah, you got some good ones. I've seen you out there.
Oh, baby. You know what? You know what I like to do? Like, I'll just like if someone else is
leading it. When I say taste test, you say come. That's the one I scream out for.
I can't hear y'all. I said.
My attitude, if I'm part of the response section of the call and response, is like, oh, I can be loud, and then I'll get other people on board and make everyone, you know, I mean, so like, right. I feel like the anonymity of the crowd, no one's really paying attention to who's like making noise. So it's mind being like the fucking loud person in that situation.
We all strike in our own ways.
It's true.
Yeah.
Some don't go to the picket line at all. Some continue to just work in movies with vouchers. There's people strike in all sorts of weird ways.
Oh, God.
By the way, Dick Dorksley is in a movie right now. So he's in that Glenn Close movie.
So you,
Close and
you said you saw Strays. I did punch up on that movie.
Did you really?
Yeah,
that's cool.
Yeah. I'm gonna see it tomorrow though. I want to see. I don't know what jokes got in. Maybe seven or nine.
There's a joke in that like I really genuinely laughed at.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. There's a really funny.
All right. I'm gonna go see it tomorrow like afternoon. See how.
I was trying to support.
That's great. We want theatrical comedies to succeed.
Yeah.
Of course.
It's almost a bummer that it's like, oh, it is like animals instead of human beings.
Right.
But like, there's actors voicing them. It's fine.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like you want a thing that doesn't need a hook.
Exactly.
Comedies to be in theaters again. Mm-hmm. But we're not allowed to write them or talk about them.
Oh, yeah. Oh, we're not supposed to promote this, huh?
I mean, like, I'm not promoting Strays at all. I was being critical of it. So.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, I don't even know if my jokes got in, so I don't know if I had anything to do with that movie.
I've done those jobs before, and it's like you do punch up on something, and then, like, it comes out, and, like, you might, like, it is, like, you try to, you're kind of hunting for, like, oh, wait, like, there's, like, I got like 2.5 things in here.
Yeah,
like,
it's
like, okay, hey, that's a win.
It's fun. Yeah,
yeah right,
you're
sure.
Like, okay, there was some effort there.
Yeah.
But, you know, but it's a weird nostalgia. Like, I'm trying to figure out my Homeward Bound nostalgia. For some reason, it's not connecting with, like, I'm not feeling it. Like, I want to be like, this is like Homeward Bound. I don't know. Sure. Is it just too long ago or something? Homeward Bound, the movie?
Homeward Bound is a long time ago. And also, like, those movies are tough to be nostalgic about because you, like, you read about production. It's like 500 puppies died on the, and you're like, oh, my God.
Yeah. Grim.
Yeah. Fucking grim. So, like, I think a lot of them, I don't know which one it was, but there was one that was really bad.
Well, okay.
Was that
so
Milo and Stitch one? No, not Milo and Stitch. No, the
Milo and Otis.
I think that one had a famously high body count. And there was also, like, the... A lot of puppies got parvo and like died on the Buddies movies.
On the Buddies movies. Yeah.
So like after all the Air Buds, they did like, you know, Space Buddies and whatever. I'm sure what the first one was.
And
the first
one was Air Buddies. Where all the buddies are ghosts.
There is, yeah. Spooky Buddies. Yeah. Yeah. Treasure Buddies.
Treasure Buddies.
They're all good.
A great way to start the podcast, make everyone sad about these puppy about these buddies.
We're full of piss. What do you want?
Yeah, what the fuck do you want from us? Yeah. We didn't do it.
Piss
fuck the
and vinegar.
Fucking Disney.
I took a shot of vinegar for our cat. But I do have to pee a lot lately. Does that mean I'm healthy? I want to go to the doctor. Like, is it good?
It can mean you're healthy or maybe unhealthy. It can mean, I think it can mean either one.
If you're staying hydrated and you're urinating a lot, I think that's good. I think if you're like, if you're peeing a lot and you don't understand why, that could be a sign of something.
You know what I've noticed lately? You're probably okay. Too much information, but I'm going to go with it. Dribble stream. I want that stream to get a little.
That's aging. That's the natural aging problem.
Really?
Like it's not strong enough anymore.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah.
Like
I'd be
peeing on the floor sometimes now.
Yeah, that's what's happening.
That's
to me.
Weird. Like, cause I never like the bowl is right there. I don't know. If that makes me feel really old, like I'm like just not getting it in there. Kinda.
No. Yeah, I used to have that fucking jet stream. Like, bam. Like, just got you.
Jesus like Christ.
Exactly. And now, yeah, no, it's a little bit of
Natalie's finding holes in the wall.
Well, okay, so I've embraced, while we're in you're in town, I have embraced the sit-down pee. And that's the big thing. I love that. That's my default pee now. I just sit down. And it's like, first off, it's a chance to sit down, especially I've been walking around or whatever. But then also, I don't have to worry about the dribbles.
Get a little dip for your...
Okay.
Dip for your dong, all too. Right. I'm saying you, not me. I'm not getting close.
It'd be hitting the water, Nick. You'd be hitting the water down there?
Well, look.
I'm hoping to get past the lid.
Man, it got nasty up in here. I was thinking the cup thing is interesting. Like, because there's like that myth of, or I don't know if it's a myth, but like how people at restaurants, if they're mad at you, they come in your food or whatever.
Oh, yeah, right.
So
it'd
be interesting if y'all did it. But the cum was from different people's restaurant, like workers at different restaurants.
Oh, right.
If you could taste it or whatever. I don't know if there would be
this is from Maggiano's. This is from Subway.
That would be so gross. But, you know, that's just a thought.
No, I mean, that's a good pitch.
Yeah.
Look, that's what the punch-up process is. Like, you could throw an idea out there, and maybe when you listen to the episode, that idea will be
I'll
part
see,
of it.
I'll see if it's there.
Hey, okay, all right.
Like, I had to punch-up on that episode. I was a guest on. I had one joke. I did a punch-up on the cum joke they had. But I don't think it's in there.
Let's talk food a little bit because we were at the restaurant and Lamar, you were telling me that you like have grown to love home cooking. You are a big time like just chef in your own home.
Not for me.
Yeah,
I don't like home cooking. Give me the takeout.
What do you not like about it? Because I've been trying to figure out what. Because there's times where I'm like, don't want to do it. Is it just the cleanup? I feel like the cleanup.
I'm joking a little bit, but yes, for real. For me, I mean, like I love someone else's home cooking. I don't like my home cooking. I don't think I'm a great chef, first of all. Mm. I think that is an issue.
I thoroughly reject that, Mitch. I've had your bar pizza. You can follow a recipe. If you put your mind to it, you can execute good food.
I haven't like worked well. For dinner, I haven't worked with proteins in a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I've worked with them in other ways.
I think there's like...
What? We talked cum earlier. I can't make a joke now saying I've worked with proteins, meaning like I jacked off.
It just so sounded gross the way you said it.
So here's what I think, what I realized, because I never thought I was a good cook, but I realized that if you like good food, you're probably a good cook, because you have the what you're like, you're just, I'm just putting in what I think tastes good.
That's
and then it's like so when I'm like one of the lessons I learned, like I was messing up a lot because during the pandemic I started cooking and it was just bad. It was gross. And then one of the things when I was watching videos how to do it, one of the rules is like you got to taste it as you're doing it.
Sure.
Like, so every time you put seasoning, like taste this. And then now I'm like, ooh, that tastes good. And then so when it comes out, I'm like, really into it because it's just like I like how food tastes, or I like good food.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've just been cooking more because of the strike, really. I'm just broke and I have to. I like eating out a lot, but I just like, now I'm like, okay, let me figure out how to like feed myself. Like,
do you have a go-to dish to prep?
Steak. Like I do a ribeye. I've been doing this, not a ribeye, New York strip.
Okay.
With a side of asparagus. And then I do this red wine mushroom sauce that's like so good with these portobello mushrooms. I cut it up and put a little garlic in there, like saute it. Then put a little red wine and a little cornstarch and it's good gravy and drip it all over the steak. Man, you know
what
I'm saying? Yeah.
How do you cook that steak?
Medium rare, and of course, yeah.
In a cast iron? What are you doing?
No, in a cast iron. And we're doing the cast iron with the rosemary, some garlic, and butter. Yeah, I like it. Yeah, just like little old school style. But I've been doing good. If you want to come on, I've been doing this thing that's kind of creepy. It's not creepy, but I think it comes off creepy. But like if I have friends who are in a relationship, and I know both of them, like I had a couple that I know that just got married or whatever. And I was like, I invited them over to cook for them. And whenever I meet people who are in relationships, I'm like, I'll cook for you and your wife or whatever.
Wow.
But it's because I
don't.
That's
not creepy at all.
Is that creepy?
That's great.
That's great.
Okay. I just prefer that than to like, just like say it's just me and you. You know what I'm saying? I just don't want to cook for this like adult man.
Yeah, sure. No, I get that.
Like, what are you doing in my house? But then when it's like, I don't know. I don't like cooking for myself either.
Yeah, sure.
Because that feels depressing because it's good. So it's just a way for me to like test out my skills on it seems like you'll get something out of it. It's something nice for y'all to do.
That's a treat.
Yeah, I'm inviting you right now.
Yeah, Nick and I can come over.
You guys can come. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, you guys can do it together. Yeah,
that will be creepy.
No, that'd be great. That's not just a fun social thing. That's a format. And I'm not saying you have to like turn that into something, but that's like third wheel. That could be a show.
Oh yeah, like the third wheel, the third wheel chef.
Third
or
meal.
Yeah. I think it could be fun. I mean, I like doing it. It's just especially when your friends get married and stuff, you just don't see them anymore. So it's just a way to stay in touch and hang out with them without them having to feel like they gotta leave the partner at home or whatever.
I love that. Okay, so you're talking about the steak with like a, what do we call it? Like a Madeira sauce? Just a mushroom?
Just mushroom red wine sauce. Yeah.
Okay, so you've got that but that to me seems a little bit elaborate. There's some steps involved. You got to have some, a nicer ingredients. Do you have a go-to like easy dish?
Easy dish is this fried cabbage. So just some fried cabbage and some sauces. Put it up in there with some peppers. Ooh, boy. Swear to God, you'll love it.
Wow.
I mean, I know you don't eat meat, but we could do like a vegetarian version of that easy.
Oh, that's awesome.
It is really good.
Wow.
Yeah. You like that?
He eats some. Well, you know, red meat is the one he does.
Yeah.
Okay. So you'll like eat some andouille, some chicken andouille?
Yeah, I would 100% do that. Yeah.
What about bacon?
I don't eat pork right now. Yeah. Okay. So.
Yeah, yeah.
Is it pig based?
Yeah, I'm trying to avoid pig, like eating pigs. It makes me feel, I don't know. I felt that was the thing I felt weirdest about. And especially when I was eating no meat at all for a while, then coming back to it is just like, I just don't have a craving for this anymore. I don't know.
I try not to think about it at all. And I'm hoping the pigs I'm eating are evil.
I can get to it. There's some that are just like bad.
Yeah, there's going to be bad pigs. Here's the thing that I always order out and I can't make a good version of. I really don't think I can. And I also think that when you order it out, it is way more fresh and they just have all the ingredients in stock. But I just had a salad from Sweetgreen.
Fun.
Mm-hmm.
And every time I try to make a salad that's as good, it's not gonna happen.
Oh, salads are
they're hard to make, right?
Yeah.
Here's the thing. I think I can make a good salad. I think it's pretty straightforward. It's just a matter of you want to have like some fresh ingredients, but honestly, I think a lot of times people overthink it. They put in too many components. I think if you've got like a base of greens, just some greens you like. You have like some sort of protein you're going to use to like anchor it. And then it's just like whatever you got, you got some bell peppers, dice those up. You got some, you can throw mushrooms in there if you like those. You can throw in some celery, throw in some cucumbers, but just pick like three or four things and throw those in there with the greens and then throw on the protein and the dressing your choice.
This is like
usually
very
solid.
Functional people
yeah.
who are like, go to the grocery store every day.
I
like,
don't have any vegetables in my refrigerator.
So that's the thing. So like, if you start incorporating like, okay, I want to have some stuff on hand to be able to make some salads, you know, throughout the week. And I am not always great about it. Sometimes I'll just like, I've got greens and like some cherry tomatoes and that'll be enough.
Does it look good though? Like, I feel like every time I make a salad, it looks shitty.
Yeah.
Like it doesn't look pretty like when you go to a restaurant.
Yeah.
Like, how do they make it so like
it's tough to, I will more just like toss it with the dressing. So I'm like how it looks, I'm less worried about. You know, the thing that helps is having
a big bowl is helpful.
Big bowl. And look, we got some big bowls. We got like some big, like ramen sized bowls that are great for those. But what I was going to say is
relax. You don't have to fucking brag about your big bowls.
They're big. I'm just saying. The other thing I was going to say is have some dry components like some. Some nuts.
You got some big bowls on it.
I got their big.
They be hitting the water with the big bowls. This shit is crazy. I got that same problem. Like, it be like splash. It's a dude getting freaky in here. It's just, I'm full of pee. I have to pee so bad.
We're coming up on a break. The have some dry components, like have some like some nuts or some seeds, because those will keep forever. And like I got some slivered almonds, or I've got some, you know, sunflower seeds or whatever, just whatever I like that's got a little bit of crunch, and I can throw that in there.
What's
you
your
know?
Dressing? What's your go-to dressing?
Well, look, you can make like a Caesar dressing or a ranch dressing, things like that are pretty easy to make fresh on your own. So like I'll oftentimes do something like that.
Should sound like work.
Yeah. Or but also like you just get like a nice green goddess dressing, like something that has to be get something that's in the refrigerated section of your grocery store because it's like going to be a little fresher and a little nicer.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's a good little tip.
Okay. Let me tell you, my mom makes a Caesar salad. I think it's like maybe even from an old Betty Crocker cookbook. It is fucking good as hell.
Wow.
It's really good. Because you know what? I can maybe tell you what it is. It's romaine. You got romaine.
Sure.
And then I think it's lemon juice, Worcestershire sauce, and a coddled egg. I think that's what it is. I think you can add anchovies if you want. We never do. And then I think so you coddle the egg, you mix all that together, the lemon juice and then Parmesan cheese. But then also we toast up some Italian bread.
Oh,
we put some butter on there.
Yeah.
And then we put some garlic salt on there. Oh my goodness.
Man.
That's pretty much it. So if you want to try it,
So that's another thing. Like if you don't mind throwing some croutons in there, it's like you get some like old bread and you just bake your own croutons. You put some seasoning on them, some olive oil. That's a dream.
There's olive oil.
Is that bad? Is that easy?
That's pretty straightforward. Yeah.
You put garlic cloves in the olive oil and then I think you use the olive oil too.
Wow.
That's the other part of it. Yeah. It's good. It's good as hell.
Right.
Michael, don't reveal my Caesar salad recipe.
Michael, I've overcoddled the egg. I feel like I've heard that before.
Let's talk Mexican food a little bit because, Lauren, last time we spoke when we were talking about what you wanted to review.
I actually was shocked that you hadn't been to this place. I thought this was a spot that you love.
Right, because you were saying you wanted to review a Mexican place when we did the podcast next.
Oh,
and we pitched some options to you. But, like, what do you go...
Oh, did I say that? I was wondering... I was wondering why. I was like, why is it all Mexican food? Cause then I was like, I want that shit. No, I did. I probably said that.
You 100%
I wanted it at the time.
Because
there's that spot across the street that it just like probably was on my mind. But lately I've been. That spot. The spot we went to.
Yeah.
I been wanting to go there. I keep hearing about it, and I was like, "Ooh, let's do that." So I was like really excited. I love Mexican food. Yeah.
You 100% asked for a Mexican chain specifically, and then I love that you forgot about it because it must have been so.
Because it must have been at least in like a couple months.
Yeah.
It was like I thought you were doing like some kind of like Mexican extravaganza, some kind of.
No, this is not the Return to Mouth of the Border. This is an individual episode. But
I don't even remember Mouth. Is that the burrito competition?
Yeah, we did. That was like 2018 or something. Mm. Oh, so what is your what are your favorites like in terms of dishes and or restaurants?
I love burritos. I love I love Hugo's Tacos right on up in Atwater. That's
good
my spot. I go there all the time. They got a real good. I love they got the black beans with the rice in there. I like burritos with rice in them.
Oh yeah.
And then there's a cool little. I love breakfast burritos. There's this like spot up in Corner Cottage up in Burbank. They got good ass breakfast burrito, but it closes at 11. So I actually now when I will be striking up and when I'll be up at Disney, then I'll be pulling up because I'm actually up in that side of town. But I think for the most part, burritos and tacos. Yeah, that's pretty much how I get down. But
Have you had Cactus Taqueria?
Yeah, you know, I used to go there when I first moved to LA all the time. That was like my go-to spot.
Have they slipped a little bit? Maybe.
I don't know. I could go back.
They're good as
I
hell. Guess
I feel like they're not over where I live anymore. It's like, I got to like really go there.
Right.
To get to it.
There's one on Vine. And Cactus is my favorite.
That's
what
I used to go to all the time. Yeah.
Cactus is my favorite burrito in LA. I love it. I've talked about this.
Good spot. Yeah, you have. Yeah. Yeah.
But they have been around for a while now. They expanded a little bit, much like today's chain. They're kind of a similar, but also Cactus was that place on Vine was like very much a hole in the wall. And then the ones in Burbank kind of nicer. The ones in the Valley are like nicer. This place, the place we're talking about today, always kind of a pretty nice spot.
Yeah, I've never been to the original location, but every one I've been to is
similar.
What's
the original location?
The original one is in, I think it's in Boyle Heights. Yeah, in Boyle Heights. Yeah,
Thought, cool. I thought this was the original
location. No, this is not the original one. The original one is further east. But like, so.
This one's been around for, this is the second location then, right?
Yes, I think so.
Because this one's been around forever.
Yeah, but all the ones I've been to have been consistent in terms of like decor and vibes, you know?
Yeah. And it feels nice. It feels like a nice. It's not, I wouldn't say upscale, but it feels like a pleasant,
approachable.
Yeah, it
you
felt
know,
like,
but, yeah.
It felt great when I was with the Aerotrop. We just felt, I just felt like I could be here all day. I was bummed out to leave, but I think that's like a good, it just felt like a cool restaurant.
Yeah.
Not to mention the two guys who took care of us, who, because you have their names.
Yeah, I sure do. You know what? We'll get to that right after this break. We'll be back with more Doughboys.
Wow.
All right. I'm gonna go pee.
Yeah, go for it.
I got piss. We're gonna piss.
We're taking pee breaks. This episode is sponsored by BetterHelp. You know, Mitch, I think we've both been dealing with things this year where we felt uncertain about where we're going in life, not sure what the right path is, and how to get through this crazy path.
I don't know how to find the path, Wags. I'm pathless sometimes.
You know, sometimes in life we're faced with tough choices, and the path forward isn't always clear, to your point. We don't know where that path is. Maybe you're thinking about a career change or feeling like your relationship needs some TLC. Whatever it is, therapy can help you map out your future and trust yourself to find the way forward.
Wags, you know, I'm always a better person when I go to therapy. I get the gunk out of my head. I talk it out. I feel better. It's out there. It's like going to the gym, working your muscles.
There you go.
Working the biggest muscle of all, the brain.
Getting a good sweat in, a good brain sweat.
Yeah, brain sweat. Yeah.
And you know, I've also benefited from therapy myself, Mitch. It's helpful for learning positive coping skills, how to set boundaries. It empowers you to be the best version of yourself. And it isn't just for those who've experienced major trauma. So if you're thinking of starting therapy, give BetterHelp a try. It's entirely online, designed to be convenient, flexible, and suited to your schedule.
Just fill out a brief questionnaire to get matched with a licensed therapist and switch therapists at any time for no additional charge.
Find more balance with BetterHelp. Visit BetterHelp.com/Doughboys today to get 10% off your first month.
That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/Doughboys. Do it.
Wow. Mitch, over 60% of Americans believe the most useful second language in the U.S. is Spanish. I mean, how can you argue with that? You want to take some time this fall to brush up on what you didn't learn in high school? No problemo. That's no problem in Spanish. Because with Babbel, you start speaking a new language in just 3 weeks.
Excelente.
This fall, you can start speaking a new language with Babbel. Why Babbel? Because it works. Instead of paying hundreds of dollars for a private tutor or fooling yourself with language apps that are little more than games, Babbel's quick 10-minute lessons are designed by over 150 language experts to help you start speaking a new language in as little as 3 weeks.
Uy, caliente.
Okay, all right, getting somewhere. Babbel is designed by real people for real conversations. All of Babbel's tips and tools for learning a new language are approachable, accessible, rooted in real-life situations, and delivered with conversation-based teaching. Mitch, I've used some of the aforementioned apps, other apps that are more like games than actual language learning systems. And the thing is, you don't really go anywhere with those. But with Babbel, those courses will teach you real-life conversation skills. You can pick up on how to order food, ask for directions, speak to merchants, and you don't have to consult language apps while you're on vacation.
Wow, Wags. I hope you go on a vacation soon, and we take some time off of Doughboys. Studies from Yale, Michigan State University, and others continue to prove Babbel is better. For instance, one study found that using Babbel for 15 hours is equivalent to a full semester at college.
With over 10 million subscriptions sold, Babbel is real language learning for real conversations.
Hey, I thought I was going to go back to school, but maybe I'll just do Babbel instead.
Yeah, that's what they do for the reboot. Coming soon to a streaming service. Here's a special limited time deal for our listeners to get you started right now. Get 55% off your Babbel subscription, but only for our listeners at babbel.com/doughboys.
Get 55% off at babbel.com/doughboys, spelled Babbel, BABBEL.com/doughboys.
Rules and restrictions may apply.
You like that line?
Welcome back to Doughboys. We're with Lamar Woods talking about guisados. Now, look, here's a little something.
Yeah.
A lot of podcasts, and there's a peek behind the curtain for people who aren't in the industry, maybe just can listen to these things. A lot of podcasts, they take a fake break. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It'll be like Scott Aukerman will be like, all right, we'll take a break. All right, we're back from break. And like, if you're in the room recording it, it'll be like you're doing...
Calling out Scott.
Specifically Scott Aukerman. We'll do this.
He's the father of fake breaks.
Yeah. And so there will be a lot of podcasts do this though. It's just for efficiency's sake.
I
think
on mine too, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Take a break.
We took a legit break. We took an actual break. All three of us urinated. We all are drained of piss.
Mm-hmm.
I would call myself a dry guy at this point.
Yeah. I feel great. I feel relieved. Yeah.
We take a break. We say, take as much time as you want. You can take a couple hours if you want to. We're cool with anything.
Sometimes a guest leaves and then we don't have an episode. That's fine. We'll work with it.
I can't believe you're going to piss off the Podfather like that. You're going to wake up with the top half of a MeUndies in your bed. I couldn't think of a horse equivalent.
It's industry-wide. It's a thing that a lot of people do.
Here's the thing. I went to take a piss.
Yeah.
I'm pissing. I pissed out my vinegar, Wags.
Oh, man.
Oh, no.
So now I'm just filled with piss. No vinegar.
You got to be careful which ball you're pissing out of.
I know.
they go separately.
Yeah.
Ladies don't know this. Guys can choose which ball they piss out of. It's a thing we do. And it's a thing you only know if you're a dude. It's
only dudes know
right,
this.
Boys?
Yeah.
It's a dude thing. Guisados was founded in 2010 in the Boyle Heights neighborhood of L.A. The Armando De La Torre Sr. and Jr. are behind this company. There are 8 locations in the greater L.A. area. The menu is taco-focused, I would say. They have a few other items, but it's really driven towards tacos, and their tacos are just fresh tortillas made to order, and they're all topped with braised and stewed proteins. They're not really, grilling anything. Everything's in some sort of stew.
Did I tell you that when I had one of my balls hurt? One of my testicles hurt.
Uh-huh.
Sorry. And I went to the doctor, and they did, did a scan on my balls.
Yeah.
And he's like, one of your balls is smaller than the other one and smaller than normal. So I have one kind of I got a weak ass ball. One of my balls is a weaker ball.
A runt?
I got a runt.
Oh, man.
Oh, wow.
One of my balls is a runt.
You couldn't tell from looking or just?
I mean, it looks like a family of runts down there.
Your other ball is also smaller than normal.
But this one comparatively is smaller. Yeah.
But compared to the other one, it's huge.
Yeah, I got a runt. I got one. I got one runt ball.
Wow.
Anyways, what are you saying? You're talking about the food.
The father and son who started this business together, the small business out of nothing, disgracing it. I didn't know that it was homegrown. I was curious if it were and I also didn't know it was a stew base like that.
Yes, yeah. Well, yeah. That's the thing. I read when I was reading about it, and I sort of was like, oh yeah, I guess every time I've had something from there, it's something that's just been simmering for a while, you know?
Yeah.
Stew based sounds like a certain TV show.
I love this place, and I think sometimes our listeners I know there's been some exasperation recently when we cover a place that's pretty exclusive to LA, this is a place I do feel if you're coming to LA, make a trip to Guisados and try it out, because it's it's just a great taco shop.
It's one of the spots I tell people to go.
Also very approachable. If you're not hey, I don't know, I'm not necessarily comfortable going to a random truck on the street and just ordering. I'm in over my head because I don't normally do that. This is a place where you can go and have things explained to you and understand
they'll
exactly what you're getting into. Yeah, so
they'll
help you out. It's great from that standpoint.
It was a father-son combo, huh?
That's right, yeah.
I didn't really hear it. Can you say it again?
The whole thing?
I guess not the whole thing.
Armando De La Torre Sr. and Jr., the father and son.
I was thinking about my runt ball. I'm sorry. I zoned out. I'm sorry. But I do like that it is not a appropriated restaurant.
Yes, and it's also like, no, that's absolutely a great point. And it also is not a place that has decided to like partner with a franchising company and be like, now there are like 200 guisados all over the country, and it's kind of like generic and
it felt
has lost
very
its
like if you would have told me that was the original, I would have believed. I'd be like, 100%. This feels like the only version of this.
Yes.
Because in LA, you'll go to like Juan's Taqueria. And then, like, there'll be, like, some white lady in there. You're like, is this the lady, the owner of this place? And
yeah,
is a lot of the time is what happens. It's like,
they be getting down.
Not to say that those restaurants can't be good and you can't be inspired by other food, but I do like that it's not, like, some random white dude who owns Guisados.
Right, 100%.
Yeah.
So we went to the Echo Park location, and this is my
spot. This is my location.
Let me say this, Mitch. You and I had we'd reached out to Lamar and be like, hey, we're gonna go at this time if you want to make it, and you're kind of like, I got something going on. Then you surprised us by showing up. You pulled a susser.
It was wild.
What a move.
I didn't think I could make it, but I was like, you know what? It's Wednesday. I'm going to pull up on y'all. And I could not tell you how perfect the timing was.
Yeah.
Like, we literally arrived at the same time.
We were there at the same exact time. It was perfect timing. Susser doesn't think that it counts as showing up as a surprise because you are the guest. He says it only counts as a Susser surprise if you have nothing to do with the episode and then go and get a meal for free.
Yeah, because that's typically his move.
Like, so if I wasn't guesting this week, I just popped up on y'all.
Yeah.
Which is impossible for anyone else to do. Except for Susser.
He's the only one that can do that.
He's the only one who can do it. Like, if Emma and Amelia showed up or if Casey showed up, we'd be like, oh, good, the people who work with us are here. And Susser is just more like that. He would be like, what are you doing? Why are you here? He's the only one. But for you, it did make sense that you came. It was great. It was great timing.
Yeah.
The parking situation on that one is a little tight. There's only a few spots, but there is parking.
Ample street parking.
There's ample street parking.
Because it looked like the parking lot was Mitch helped me with that. He was like, are you sure about this? It was a good, like, 10 minutes of, like, trying to figure out if I should park here or not, even though there was clearly spaces on the street.
Lamar was in resident parking, I believe, and I was like, I don't know if that belongs to Guisados as well.
Yeah.
Guisados.
Yeah. There's also, like, we did ask Rigo and Chewy, who helped us out, how to pronounce the restaurant, the name of the restaurant, so I hope we're doing it well.
I love those two guys. They were great.
They were the best. Nice. They were so great.
You're right, but they really explained it, too, because this is my first time.
Yeah.
And... you know, I speak a little Spanish, you know, like, you know, I got some shit, but I didn't really know a lot of shit, but they was like really helpful. Like, they was like, this is what this is, this is this. And I was like, great. They didn't make me feel like an idiot or anything.
And we didn't get the name of the woman who came up to us and talked through every taco.
She was great.
She was also awesome. The staff there is great. That's been my experience every time I've been there.
Rigo?
Rigo and Chewy, yeah.
I liked Rigo a lot. He gave a shout out to maybe a show. Oh, you weren't there for that.
Oh yeah, I was. Yeah.
Oh, do you mean your show?
Yeah,
he did. He gave a shout out to you. Yeah, I know. I was there for that.
But then also he wanted to listen. Well, I think Chewy started this. Also, Jesus is his name. his name is Jesus. His name was Jesus. That sounded weird.
Wow. Okay.
Shouldn't have said it.
Not Jesus.
Rigo said Jesus.
Jesus.
So,
okay.
Yeah. So, but maybe Jesus. But that's Rigo told me Jesus. But Chewy was quite the character, and he was asking about Doughboys. He had me write down the podcast name, and then Rigo and Chewy were both saying they were going to listen to it. Yeah. And we warned them as we were leaving. I was like, "It's bad.
Might be a piss episode.
Listen to us talk about piss and cum and runt nuts.
I love it. Chewy, you gonna love this. What up, Chewy? It's me, Lamar. I didn't get to meet y'all. I left early. I had to go somewhere. But I want you to know that you guys are great. If you listen,
the best.
If you listen, they're
great. Guisados, you should be. All our experience with your employees was fantastic.
Well, okay, so, and I've been to this place a bunch, Mitch, and I think you have too, and I've been to multiple locations. Mm-hmm. Like, I've been to the West Hollywood one, I've been to the downtown one, I've been to this one, and universally, it's always, like, a very helpful, friendly staff.
Always.
And also, I would say this is a place where part of what I think makes this so accommodating and newbie-friendly is that they have a thing. First off, they have a ton of vegetarian and pescatarian options. Mm-hmm. They have two vegan tacos. And then they also have, it's like, they have a 6 mini taco sampler platter which you, both of you both got.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so I've had that before, and I kind of told Lamar, it's like, it's great to test a lot of different tacos. I don't think you get, I think if you get the individual tacos, they just are better. There's a few tacos you can't get in the sampler platter, but it's a great way to try different, like a lot of different flavors. Yeah. It's great.
If you're going for, like, this is your one visit because you're from out of town, or if you're going, like, for your first visit and you're not really sure what to get, it's, like, a great way. You can try
feel like
half their
it's
menu.
It's great for if you live here. Because I was thinking, if I just was out of town, I would wish I would have gotten, because we had that fish joint. I was like, whoa. But, like, now that I have done the sampler, like, I'm, like, craving these tacos. Like, I want to go back and get, now I know what to get.
Yes.
Yeah. Lamar ordered this, the little did he know that we were going to order like 5 pounds of food each, but he got the sampler taco platter and I was almost like, you should get more. And then I got the fish taco.
Yeah.
And we went back. He was like, can I try a bite of this? And I was like, yeah. And I was like, you know what? Have the whole thing. I'm going to go get another one because you need to have, I think that fish taco, I'm gonna say it. I think it's like one, maybe my favorite taco of all time.
It's a home run. Good. It's a great fish taco. It's a grilled fish taco. Which
you know what kind of gives it,
like the fried one, but this is the great execution, the grilled version.
It's so fucking good. And you know what it gives vibes of? Kind of gives Cool Ranch Dorito vibes.
Mm,
really? There's like a cool like that's like the sour cream and the flavors
refreshing.
Mix. It has like I don't want to scare people off because I love Cool Ranch Doritos, but like just like the kind of the flavors that you get going there, it's great.
Thank you for letting me eat that.
Of course,
Intend on just getting a bite and then leaving it, but I'm so glad you did. I enjoyed it. It was my favorite thing I had there.
That came out of my own gluttony too, where I was like, I just want a full one, so I went and got another one. But I started off with the samplers and Wags. We got to talk about it because I think it's a huge part of this place. Mm-hmm. And I'm not even a corn tortilla guy.
Yeah.
But man, those tortillas are fucking
they're
so
fantastic.
Fucking good.
And that's what really elevates a taco shop is like if they have the fresh handmade tortillas and here they have their own like masa they get and they're making them in-house and
soft,
they're made to order.
Warm.
They're so soft, they're so warm,
God.
They're delicious. And then, you know, all the proteins they put on them are so well prepared. But yeah, that pescado taco, the fish taco, it's got black beans in it, which I really like. Cabbage, avocado, cilantro, cream, which you mentioned. And it's just really well composed. I don't know. It's one of my favorite fish tacos. Mm-hmm. I love it. I got one for myself. We also got, Mitch, we each got the shrimp tacos, the camarones.
Yeah.
Which is shrimp, onion, bell peppers, and a mild chipotle sour cream.
Really, really good.
That one's great. That one's awesome.
I'm gonna ask how y'all like that.
Yeah, I like that a lot. I mean, I think you can just get fish tacos there and be set. Like, just the seafoods are great.
I'll tell you my order. My normal order. I mean, at the end when we talk about stuff more. But I have a go-to order there. I'm trying to look at the menu right now, by the way, because I want to see what my six tacos were. But I have a go-to order, and I'm never ever disappointed. Like I there's never been a time where I've gone to Guisado's and been like, that was bad. It's never happened.
Wow. I know you got the chicharron, which is like pork rinds. Mm-hmm. It's like stewed pork rinds, which I like that when I've had that in the past when I've been eating pork. And how was that for you?
I liked it. It was good. Again, it's not in my rotation of the ones that I usually get. Want me to tell you the six I got, Wags, my six sampler tacos?
Yeah.
I got the steak picado, which is flank steak simmered in green bell peppers and bacon. There's bacon in that? Did you know that?
I didn't notice that there was bacon in there.
It's
the same thing I got, right? I need to I can't remember which was in it.
I guess bacon. I don't think there was bacon in ours. I really don't. But I did the steak picado.
I don't
remember
bacon at all. Yeah. Unless it's maybe just cooked. They just want you to know it's cooked.
There's different locations, so maybe there's no bacon in that one. But I got the Molo Poblano, which you got as well.
Yeah.
Which was fantastic.
That was banging. That was the Mole one. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. The Tinga, which is the chicken tinga. Is that one? You got
the that's the chicken
that
and
was
chicken
my
with tomatoes.
Favorite of the sampler one.
This is, I think the Tinga is maybe one of their most famous.
One's great. That's been a go-to for me. That one's awesome.
It was a little spicy too. It was good.
A little bit of spice. I got the chicharron. And then I thought that I did get the cochinita pibil. And I also got chuleta in chile verde. But I think I just named seven tacos, didn't I? One, two, three. No. No, that was six total. And Wags, the chuleta, which is chuleta and chili verde, is diced pork chop and chili verde. That is one of my go-tos every time I go.
Wow. What was that one?
This one right here.
What was that one that was like pasty looking? It kind of looked like a...
Which one
like
here?
A little paste. Was it that one? Yeah, this one.
Oh, the coaching. That's probably. Or the,
no, this one.
That okay. That's the Chicharron. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You like that one?
Nah.
Chicharron is. I mean, that's the one. That is. That is kind of. Some people don't like Chicharron.
Well, okay. So even Rigo like was like, yeah. "Have you had this before?" Like, yeah. Kind of like making sure. So like, you know, again, those look like.
Yeah, she did kind of like. It did feel like I was. This was the new thing.
Exactly.
And,
yeah.
That I was. So I was. I, you know, it tasted good. I just wasn't my.
So yours was slightly different. You got two steak tacos. And then two chicken tacos, and then I think the Chicharron and the cochinita pibil. I think those are all yours.
Yeah, that sounds right. Okay, yeah, I was like, I don't remember any. So good.
Yeah, there's two different steak ones. There's a steak picado, and there's a steak in salsa roja.
You can almost one bite these tacos.
The mini tacos are little, but the full size tacos are substantial. Yeah, like, that's like you get three or four of those, you're set.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh.
What is the right number of tacos you like in an order? I think I'm a three guy.
Me too. Yeah, I think three at the normal size. Yeah. Absolutely.
You know what's funny is this is why I always go burrito over taco. Mm. But then at a place like this, there are no burritos, and this is like I love this sort of taco shop because it is you do feel full when you get them too. But
they're substantial. And
I'm just gonna say here's my order here. Mm. I get a fish taco, and then the chuleta and chili verde, and then a quesadilla, which is like their quesadilla we haven't talked about.
Their quesadilla is fucking great. We got a second one too, right?
We got a second one. Lamar and I
this
split
one,
on.
That was banging.
It's also in the fresh corn tortilla. It's like it's like a smaller.
It's not your typical quesadilla at all. It's like a taco. It's like grilled thing of cheese in a taco. Yeah, and it's fucking.
It's like a little sandwich. It's like it's tight.
It's it's fantastic. And no, some I love that.
And some what's the? It's like a chipotle.
Yeah, it's like a chipotle
sauce.
Sour cream. It's got it's the no that is awesome. I mean, look, this is the thing is like, we're just, everything tastes so good that it's just like, yeah, that one was good. That other one was really good. It was like, I love that they have black beans on a lot of their tacos. I feel like that's not an approach you normally see, but they work really well. Right, they give them, make them a little bit more substantial.
I think
they bind to everything.
I think the fish taco is really, really special, but we tried something else there that's pretty special, Wags, which is a very hot taco.
Oh, you're talking about the chiles toreados, which was it's four different types of chilies, including habaneros and Thai chilies. They're blistered together, and then they are served on black beans, and they have some sort of chili sauce that's also on top of it. And that was the thing that was like when I had a bite of this, because this is the thing, you can't really fork and knife a taco. It just doesn't work. So we just had to take bites of this bad boy. Lamar, you smartly declined. My biggest issue is lip contact with the spicy sauce, because like that was where the burning was most intense.
Oh, so it was right here.
Yeah. That was really tough, but that one I really felt. It wasn't Howlin' Ray's Howlin' level, but it was pretty. It's pretty rough.
Like I was watching both of y'all.
Yeah, we were sweating.
It was stressing me out. Like I was like, man, these two white dudes don't look like they look like I just kidnapped them or something. And, I was like, and then the homie come back, he's like, you guys good? And I'm like, I look like perfectly normal. Like I don't know what's wrong with them. Like I get out of here. I gotta go.
I also like that I was making fun of the white lady owning a Mexican restaurant, and then now trying to say any of the names, and I'm like, Chili's Toronto. Sound like a fucking idiot. But I'll say this about that, and you were right to not try it.
Yeah.
It's hot, but it's also not. It's not challenge. It wasn't like this is gonna make you feel bad level, but. There was a poster in the front lobby.
Yes.
From Sean Evans, host of Hot Ones.
Yeah.
It said Tumsworthy for the Chili's Torado or whatever. And
yeah, that's a good assessment.
I think Tumsworthy is good. It has heat, but I think that taco is actually enjoyable.
Yeah, it tastes good. And
eating the whole thing would have been tough. And I think that maybe it will give you some tummy trouble, but it's not like Howlin' Ray's, which again, we loved Howlin' Ray's, but Howlin' Ray's, but it's that sort of thing of like Howlin' Ray's put me out of commission for when I did the Howlin' level, it put me out of commission for like 3 days.
That's tough stuff. Really? That really fucked me up. Wait, Lamar, we talked about this and we talked about this previously, but you're someone who like you, as you've gotten older, you can't handle spicy foods anymore, just like digestively.
Yeah.
Which is a fate I fear is like approaching for me. Like I feel like I'm starting to feel that now. It's punishing my body more and more.
I don't know what to do. You know, I it's my favorite type of food, you know, I abstain because I probably would have done it But I had some spicy food like the night before.
Okay.
And it hurt my stomach pretty bad. So I was kind of in recovery mode. So I was like, there's no way I can do this again. But I'm just trying to figure out a balance. Like I don't want to give the shit up completely. But I got to, like, I can't just not eat spicy food anymore.
Yeah.
Like, what the hell? Like, what the fuck is that shit? But yeah, we talk about it every time we get here. I'm like, it's not going away. Yeah. I wish there was like some cure though. Like, is there like a cure for like I was telling him, like, is there like a lactate? Like, you know how you take lactate for dairy? And by the way, I can't eat dairy, and I ate that cheese thing. I had no problems, which was interesting. So when it's good cheese, when it's not like some like that shit you like really cheap shit.
I can
handle it. But I was thinking there'd be a cool medicine if you take it before you eat spicy food.
Yeah, that's great.
And if your stomach is fine, that would be awesome. It's got to be something like that.
I wish that there was. As we talked about, Homer drank wax in the Simpsons episode. To you want something like that, basically. What is the type of cheese that is on the quesadilla?
Queso panela. Yeah, it's kind of like a griddled block of cheese. It's not like shredded cheese.
Sad, your ghost of Christmas future is going to just show you like on the toilet, basically. He's going to jump ahead a year and just show you sitting on a toilet.
Yeah,
what
a bummer. Yeah.
That's a bummer.
I don't know what the move is, because like I do like spicy foods, and I do find myself opting more and more for like I'll do like a medium or a, you know, or pick the non spicy things of the options, you know, just because like I feel so punished later, but like I guess you just have to
it's over
exercise some restraint. It's a bummer.
It's over.
I love
for
it
me.
Too.
Look, I'll still take bites of stuff like that and try things, but like I'm never ordering. Yeah. I'm never ordering the spicy level. I'm like going mild on buffalo wings a lot of the time.
Yeah, I have to just be. It's almost a thing I need to talk about in therapy, because it's like psychological. Like I have not accepted this is the man I am. Like I was on this date. We went to I know it was Mexican food too. It was like a couple of days in a row.
Yeah.
But we went to a Mexican restaurant. I'm getting like tacos and all types of shit, putting hot sauce on it, just trying to, you know, have a good time. And we went to a bar after, and it was just like lightning. And I had to go right to the bathroom. And it was one of those bars where like the bathroom is like, it's just one bathroom. It was many people. It was so stressful. I was in there.
Oh
like,
my God.
I was like in there like going, I was sweating. I was like to the part, I was like, I'm going to have to leave. I'm going to have to tell her. I was going to text her like, I'm sorry. Like, and it was really vulnerable. I got out. I told her like, because there was no way at this point I was in there so long. She was like, I can't just lie.
Yeah.
And I was like, look, I'm, you know. I don't know what happened there, but I just want you to know, like, this is who I am. This is the guy you're hanging with.
Yeah,
we can keep going if you want. I feel fine now, and she was like, she pulled out a thing of Rolaids and gave me some. You know, I think I'm in love. I don't know.
Fucking took care of my ass.
I was like she was so nice about it.
I shit too moment is really nice.
Yeah.
This is like a same thing. I remember I went to Hyperion Public.
Mm-hmm.
I think I was with Mookie and Dutz. I think it was the duo who I met there. And I was like, my stomach is really hurting. They're like, you'll be fine. There's no one in the bar. And then I had to shit in the Hyperion Public. And it's one of those scenarios. There's two bathrooms there, luckily, but still, it's that sort of thing where you're like, the worst experience in the world.
No one wants to shit.
Especially at a bar, because people are drinking a lot, so they don't care. Like, they have to pee too. So they're like, I have to pee. Wait, what's going on in there? Who's in there? But for some reason, also, this bathroom at this bar had like a lot of pornography all over the wall.
Then you got to jack off, too. No, this is ridiculous.
It was so strange. But anyway, it's so stressful. But now, so I think the right thing to do is just been like, at the dinner, I should have just not ate. I should have avoided. It's like you have the tough conversation then to avoid the pain. Like, you know, because I'm always just hoping I get lucky and not have any problems. But here's the point where it's every time now.
Here's the sad thing is like even the sweet green hot sauce, I think, gives me problems. I'm like, it's bad. I love spicy stuff too. Maybe if I get my guts in order, things will work out. I like do need to get my guts in order a little bit, but. Yeah. Like if I don't do it for a while, just relax. Maybe I'll get back some.
You take the probiotics? You take those?
No, those also mess up with my. Those also. Whenever I'm eating Greek yogurt, I always feel good.
Oh, so crashing the yogurt train.
I know. You're right. You send me your picture of your yogurt every day.
When I'm on a Gert kick, I'm like, I'm loving it.
Yeah.
We got our group chat, and we're Gert chat with Dunktown, where we're sending yogurt pics all the time.
I feel like
that's like very like we're all like when someone's sending yogurt pictures, we're all having more yogurt.
Yeah.
And then if someone falls off, it's like everyone stops eating yogurt.
Yeah.
I feel like we just got to police ourselves a little bit more.
I got to eat more yogurt, and I got to say, using the bathroom in a bar like that is the worst.
The fucking worst. Wait, have you ever run into this where it's like a bathroom where it's got a urinal and a toilet? It's got both.
Yeah.
And so like, and you were like, I've got to take a shit, and there's other people waiting, and then the guy goes in and is like, there's two.
They don't want to give you that privacy.
Yeah, it's like,
what the fuck?
I don't want
to. That's like, Reed Rustic is like that.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I can't shit here. I'm like exposed to the...
Yeah.
Birds used to have an exposed toilet.
That was fucking insane.
And I had walked in there when guys were just taking...
What
type of human being are you taking?
What are you
taking?
What are you doing?
Get the
animals.
Fuck out of there.
You're not going to block the door?
Like, I'll be out in a second. It's just open.
Yeah, it's open. That's like happened on more than one
occasion.
That's
the logic, though. I don't know who created that system. In my mind, I'm like, the logical thing to do is to, you know, leave the door open so someone else can use it. But like... Because it's like, I feel like the way that it's built for two people to be in here.
Yes.
Sure, yeah.
But I don't want to do that.
No.
But with birds, it's just an open toilet. There's no, you're not behind any door.
No, yeah, you're just exposed. What are you, Johnny Sack and the Sopranos? Just taking a fucking open door shit? What's going on here? Are you fucking Lyndon Johnson? Hazing a reporter? What are you doing?
That's like I think that's the most confident thing you can do in the world.
Yeah.
Is it just like, I'm going to take a shit on this toilet and people can come in and come out and I don't give a shit. That's insane.
Yeah, it's insane. I can't imagine that.
That's so insane.
It's insane.
The other worst spot to go to the bathroom is right next door at UCB, another horrible place where people would do warm-up improvs and I'd be going by to use the toilet.
Yeah.
Fucking awful.
Or like changing into a sketch costume.
Any situation, I feel like, and look, the HeadGum bathrooms are unfortunately also an offender. Anytime it's like the single-use bathroom... Mm-hmm. And there's other people just like around. It's like, I want to fucking, you know.
We work with a bunch of hunks.
Exactly.
They take shits. They don't even have to wipe. They're good to go.
It's just clean. It's just shining. They just come out shining, ready to go.
So many benefits to being a hunk. I also got
was in the bathroom at UCB and a rat jumped on his shoulder.
What?
Yeah. Nightmare.
That is
kind of funny and cute.
It is funny.
I mean, it's adorable.
Climbed into his hat and did improv for him.
He's like, can I get a word? Cheese. fuck. The rat just pissed off. Say that shit every time.
I'm a cat and Neil gets scared, runs off stage. I do the same thing too. I like if I go on a date or if I'm meeting someone, I'm like, just so you know, like my stomach hurts 90% of the time. Yeah. And a thing that I would never want to talk about with like a possible like someone who I want to like or want to date or something.
Yeah, it's
this
hard.
This is like a thing I now like. You just have to be like, hey,
You know what sucks about that though? Like if you continue to see that person, they're kind of they start policing you a little bit, like because now they don't want to deal with it. Like
So
if I'm like. Like, if I would go out again, I'm like, ooh, I should get, like, I'm going to get a little quesadilla. And she's like, you sure you want to do that? it's like they do it, like, they care, but they're also, like, not, they're like, I'm not taking care of your ass. Then I'm like, I just want
to. That makes more sense. When you first said it, I was like, she's not letting me, like, I got to go to the bathroom. I'm like,
I don't
you hold
want
that in.
That's what you thought. Like she just wasn't letting me, by her policing me.
Yeah.
It's like once you tell me, like, and once you confess that, day, like, look, I'm gonna tell you right now, you're not shitting when you with me. I don't do that with any partner. It's like, but I gotta go. No, you wait till this date is over. But no, I just mean you can't be as loose with food around them now because it's like, you know, it's like if I just got sober and. You know, but I'm like, I feel like I can handle a couple glasses of wine, but maybe you knew the worst version of me.
Yeah.
And when we hang out, you're like, you sure you want to do that?
Yeah,
and I'm
exactly.
Like, it's like, I just want to have a glass. I'm fine.
Yeah.
It's like, I just want a little hot wing. Just let me get a chicken wing. But it's fine. But yeah, so it's a little struggle, but you know, I think I just got to be honest with where we are.
Yeah.
It's not going, it's like, I thought it'd be a phase, but it, like literally, when the first time I came on this pod, it was like, almost 5 years ago or something.
Was that long ago?
It was a long time ago, but that was the first time I brought it up because I had that. It was the last time I had a Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich.
Right.
Yeah. I thought it would go away, and here we are.
And that's not even that spicy, Zach.
No.
Yeah. So it's just not going away. You know, whatever.
Well, all of that to say, I had this happen on our first date at Marvin, the restaurant, Marvin Gray restaurant. And it's also a restaurant that doesn't have too many bathrooms. So it was like embarrassing in every way.
Yeah.
Just a nightmare. Go back to the table fucking sweaty. Yeah. Fucking sucks. anyways, all that to say, this taco's pretty spicy.
It is spicy. It's good. It's decently spicy. Yeah.
It's got good flavor. It's not a thing that.
No, that's what I like. It's not just a dare food. It's like it's a dish. And I think if you want something legitimately spicy, you know, try it out. But just be forewarned. They had a daily special, which was a beans and papas taco, potatoes.
You got that, right?
And I got that, and it was one where it's just like It's so simple, but this is so flavorful, and I kind of want to try it just because of the simplicity of it. I like a potato taco, but this is a really well-executed version. It was great.
I just felt bad thinking about the Guisados guys listening to the podcast.
This place is so fucking good is a thing.
It's so good.
This episode is so disgusting.
We talked about shitting. We took a break to talk about shitting for 15 minutes.
Like, I will say, and I was worried. I ate almost everything except for that one thing. Thing you were saying.
The spicy taco, right?
Yeah, that and there's
the shrimp taco?
The pasty looking thing. What was it called?
Oh, the chicharrón. Yeah.
I didn't finish that, but because I had a meeting right after that and I was a little worried.
Yeah.
And I swear to God, like, so I'm here to tell y'all, if you have stomach issues, this place did not give me any problems. Like,
yeah.
And some of the stuff was still spicy. I still put hot sauce on it. And stuff. So it wasn't like I didn't like enjoy. Experience.
I didn't get the rumblies, and I also ate that spicy taco. I didn't get the rumblies.
Yeah, no, I was okay.
But I also say this, like a place like I don't love corn tortillas. I don't usually like stewed, like more stewed meats.
Yeah.
And I love this place. I love every taco that you could try. They're all good.
Yes.
The chicharrón, I think that's like some people don't like chicharrón. It's pork skin, but I liked everything I got. And we also got a...
We got a ceviche,
and we got a tamale.
We got a tamale, yeah. And
that was really good.
Yeah, that was fantastic. They have like four tamales, and it's just... I asked Rigo which one he liked, and he said... I think he said the pork and the cheese one, so we got the cheese one. You know what? It was fucking great. It was simple, but it was well executed. I don't know. I like this is a simple menu. I like that it's straightforward. I like that it's so focused on... You know, the thing that they do, there's a few other things that are on the menu, but it's like very straightforward again, very, very user friendly. Hey, we're going to do tacos. We're going to do them really, really well.
Yeah. Have you done the breakfast stuff?
I've not done their breakfast.
I've never tried the breakfast either.
Yeah. And they only serve their breakfast, I think, on weekends till 11.
Till 11, yeah.
I got an Armando Palmero, which is 2/3 limon, 1/3 Jamaica, and that was great. That was delightful.
I thought that was the Nick Weiger,
kind of like
way.
The Nick Weiger of south of the border. Yeah, this was great.
So my order, like I said, fish taco, the chuleta and verde sauce, and the quesadilla, and then I'll always do the limon Are these agua frescas? They are, yeah.
They have a bunch of agua frescas, yeah.
Agua frescas. I got melon instead this time.
Yeah.
That was the one I got instead of the limon.
Cantaloupe water.
Cantaloupe water. Yeah. I didn't like it as much. It's not as sweet. The limon is like, is sweet and sour. It's like just a little bit more sugary it tastes like, and it is super sour. And I like love that limon juice. And Wags, you had half of it with your Jamaica.
Yes.
But that's the drink I would go with. I think it's so good. Except there is one other drink. The horchata.
Yes, there's an horchata cold brew specifically.
Mm-hmm.
And you got one of those. And I had just a sip of it because like cold brew makes me crazy. Cold brew, you know, like that's like for you with spicy foods, I realize that if I have cold brew, I just lose my mind. Much caffeine.
It's not too bad.
Because it's just like a shot in
yeah,
like a
it's
big
more
drink.
Even yeah, I think yeah. It is just more like it's kind of just coffee level.
Right.
I had that while I fished out the ice and I finished it this morning or this afternoon on the way to Headgum. I love that. I'll talk a bit about it more in my final review.
Wow. Well, you know what? We'll get to your final review right after this break. We'll be back with more Doughboys.
Oh, shit. Our next partner is Athletic Greens. Wags, I take AG1 by Athletic Greens literally every day. I gave AG1 a try because I wanted to support better gut health. You know how my gut's been going wild?
Oh, yeah.
I need all the help I can get, and AG1 gives me that help. And you know what else it does? It's got my immune system booted up.
You can take AG1 in the morning before starting your day. It makes you feel like you're doing something good for your body, like you're giving it the nutrition it craves. You know, Mitch, it's hard to keep up with a supplement routine that comes with a bunch of different products, but AG1 makes that so much easier.
AG1 was designed with ease in mind, so you can live healthier and better without having to do a lot. AG1 is powerful because it's so easy to fit into your lifestyle. It's the healthiest thing you can do in under a minute. It's one scoop of powder mixed with water once a day. You know what? I put mine in a little yogurt smoothie.
Oh, that's a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
AG1 gives you increased energy and mood support, making it easy to live your best life. AG1 has been a part of millions of mornings since 2010. And AG1 is delivered every month, so it's super easy to make it a daily habit.
They also have single-serving travel packs, so you never have to miss a day. All you have to do is mix the powder into cold, ice-cold water and drink it first thing each morning. That's it.
With AG1, taking care of your body every day is really that simple. If you're looking for an easier way to take supplements, Athletic Greens is giving you a free one-year supply of vitamin D and five free travel packs with your first purchase.
Just go to athleticgreens.com/doughboys. That's athleticgreens.com/doughboys.
Check it out. Welcome back to Doughboys.
Why?
That was a fake break.
I was
a hypocrite.
Yeah, I know.
I quickly went to the bathroom and I pissed out piss this time. I did the other half.
You were very fast about it, yeah.
From the runt ball.
Yeah, you just sprinted over there.
But now they're both out of me, which is good because the show, we're winding down here.
It's time. I
want to go first.
You want to go first. All right, it's time for
usually
our
usually the guests go first, but I want to go first. I'm not trying to sway anyone here.
Okay.
I said this yesterday to can I go, Wags? Can I give my four score?
Yeah, go ahead.
I said this to Wags yesterday. I think this is the quintessential LA restaurant. I think it's fantastic in every way. They also, when it's Dodgers games, their horchata is blue for the Dodgers, which is cool as hell.
Yeah.
Wags.
They also did that for Avatar: The Way of Water.
Yeah, I believe so.
It was great.
When my mom is in town, she wants to go to Guisado's every time. She says it incorrectly every time, too, when she comes. But she always wants to go to Guisado's. And she says it like Siri, because Siri says Guisado's.
Yes.
She gets it wrong, too. But she loves it. It's one of her favorite restaurants. I have strong feelings for it that way. For me, it's like, if I had to give people five recommendations to go to in LA, Guisado's is one of them.
Definitely, yeah.
My mom loves that cold brew and horchata. That's what she always wants to get when she comes here. I just think it's so well done. It's so good at what it does. I love it. I have a fondness for it, of course.
Yes.
But Wags, it's joining an exclusive club.
Oh my God, I know where this is going.
It's joining a very exclusive club.
Wow.
The Six Fork Club.
Wow.
Because out of five forks, this gets six.
Holy shit.
I think that it is becoming an LA institution. I love that it's family owned. There's truly nothing I can criticize about the place.
It joins Bonchan as the only other member of the Six Fork Club.
I think
Six
so,
Forks.
Yeah.
Wow.
I mean, I
what
love
a score.
It. My mom, truly a place where, like, my mom who will forget restaurants.
Yes.
We've been everywhere in LA, and she likes a few. She likes Musso and Frank. She likes a few places. There's places that she likes, but, like, that's the spot. Every person I bring there, they're always like, this place fucking rules.
It's great.
No one dislikes that place. If you dislike that place, I think you have no taste buds.
Wow.
Six Forks.
It's like the most fired up you've been in a while.
I love it. It's great. It makes you happy. It gets me emotional.
I can't believe I picked that. I take all credit for this. I wanted Mexican. I saw you in the lobby. I said, put me on the show. We're going to do Mexican food. That's it. Nothing else. And I'm like, Guisado's. That's cool.
Wow.
I it gets me emotional because I love it's so good at what they do, and then the staff is all great.
Yeah.
There's like it's just one of the best restaurants, and that fish taco I think is maybe the best taco I've ever had. Maybe not even fish taco, maybe the best taco I've ever had.
I love that. All right, Lamar, your first visit, your thoughts, your fork score.
I mean, I loved it. I always wanted to go. I've been hearing about it a lot. I feel like people always talk about it. And I was a little nervous because I just been having a bad week stomach-wise. And I was like, I got to figure out how I'm going to eat this. But I got to say, it was every taco had so much flavor.
And they offered you the sauce on the side too, which they were cool with that. Yeah.
And even though I poured it all over the tacos anyway, I was like, put it aside. I want it on there. But and I also really liked the lady the woman who broke down the tacos for us. And even though she did it for Mitch, and like even though I had the same shit, she like did it for me too. And like wasn't annoyed by it. I'm really big on like customer service. I love that shit.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna give it it's out of five, right?
Yeah.
I can't give it a five just because I want to try more shit. Maybe I'll probably get it a four forks.
Four forks. Very good score. Yeah.
Because I want, and that fish, thank you for letting me do that fish taco. That was one of the best fish tacos I've ever had. And I had a Modelo too, a little beer. I like that they had alcohol there. I think that's something, a place that I need, like a place that is like has alcohol but isn't like me going to a bar and it just feels like I can just like get a little drink real quick.
I think that this will move up into five forks for you when you continue to go there. It never disappoints.
I will probably go back in a couple days because I feel this craving because I'm like, oh man, I feel like I want more of that, especially that chicken one, the tinga. I was like, I want more of that. But I just didn't have time to really like take all of it in.
And also, when you get the full, it's a different experience when you get the regular sized one too.
Right.
Wise, I didn't even mention we were gifted cookies at the end of our.
That's right.
What?
You were gone.
Came by with a couple of shortbread cookies. I think that was Rigo who did that. That was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Those dudes ruled. The whole staff ruled.
We had a chocolate chip one and a rainbow sprinkles one.
Yeah. Really tasty, and those are baked locally as well. I think this place is awesome. I mean, I love tacos. Mexican food is like pretty much my favorite food, and so you know, the place that does it well, like I'm gonna love it. The two things I'll say about this place, one is I feel like if we reviewed this on the road, like if we'd like hey, we're going to, I don't know, we're going to Salt Lake City, and there's this great local taco chain, and we're gonna try it out, and we had this. I would be thinking of it from that standpoint, thinking of it like this is like a tour destination sort of restaurant we go to that people were talking about, lives up to those expectations, lives up to that hype, lives up to people saying like, this place is great. You got to check it out. So like when I'm talking about a place that's in LA that I've had a number of times, I try to think of it from that perspective. And I think viewed through that lens, this place is fucking terrific. I think it absolutely delivers if you're going in with high expectations. Yeah. The other thing is, and I mentioned this earlier, it's got so many great vegetarian options, I really appreciate. And Mexican food is already very veggie friendly, but like they go out of their way to have like, you know, I think there's like seven or eight different veggie tacos on the menu and a couple of vegan options
too. You look like you had a feast. I was like, he don't even look he looks like he's really satisfied, right, with all the shit that you have.
It's great. And it's not just like, hey, this is an approximation of the meat version or whatever. This is like a fake version. It's like, no, these are actually like well thought out dishes. I love that they think of each. I love how each taco is composed, and I don't know, man. It's just great craftsmanship. If that's a good okay word to use about food, it's just like really well like curated.
It's broken down on the board too, by the way.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it's
yeah.
like fish, vegetarian, like it does all of that.
Yeah, it's broken down by category, so it's pretty again pretty user friendly. I don't know. I love this place, and you know, the question for me is, does this exceed the five fork threshold and enter the elusive six fork club? For me, I'm going to say Guisados, you may be in LA, but you might now have a Manhattan area code because you're getting 646, six forks from the Burger Boys.
Oh my God.
Shit. Yo, what am I doing here? It's crazy. Man. Changing the game out. This is crazy.
Yeah, this place is great. I was so I think
Wags first six fork score.
I think the highest compliment I can play a chain pay a chain we review on the show, because like, you know, Mitch, wow. This is work sometimes. It's like after we went, like I immediately wanted to go back. It's like, yeah. I want to get that shit again. It's fucking great.
It's so good. It truly
that's exactly how I feel. Yeah.
It truly makes me happy. And I have fond memories of going there with friends and my mom and sister every time they come here. It's like there's no other restaurant in LA that I can say that is like, every time family comes here, we go. Mm-hmm. And I know that it's easier. It's casual. But, like, that's one of them. That's the one.
For a chain that's scaled up, that now has 8 locations to maintain that level of quality and, you know, like, still make everything in-house.
It feels very L.A., too. Like, 100%. I feel like I'm in L.A. Like,
100%.
LA.
No, it fucking rocks. All right. Hey, that was our review of Guisados. Wow. It's time for a segment. Fuck, I got to step away and do this. I forgot to bring it over. Should I do the intro for the segment first and then go get it? No, I'm going to go get it first. I'll be right back.
Oh, I got to pee anyway.
Okay, we'll be right back. Welcome back. That was a real break, not at our regular break time. We're mixing things up. Mm-hmm. Ackerman's fucking spinning in his grave.
He's dead?
Yeah, sorry. Well, holy shit. Sorry to tell everyone.
Jesus.
That's how you tell us? All right.
I wouldn't put it past you to fucking. And now it's a friend's death just over the fucking.
Jesus.
Just how like you casually announced the start of the pandemic to me in our live show in Denver.
Oh my God, what a really? Weird time
you
that
came
was.
Up and said, she's like, the NBA has suspended its season. I'm like, what?
Oh, that was
we're
so
getting ready
wild.
For our meet and greet after the show.
I know. That and you know what?
Amazing, yeah.
Denver fans. Didn't like the hand sanitizer. No, I'm good. I was like, okay, it's cool.
Oh, man.
It was a different time. Look, it's time for a segment. I've chosen a cake, and Mitch and Lamar must divine a series of clues to guess what it is. The winner takes the cake. The loser goes home empty-stomached. This is Cake It Off. Cause the baker's gonna bake, 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 bake. And my belly's gonna ache, 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 ache. Baby, I'm just gonna cake, 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 cake. I'll cake it off, I'll cake it off, ooh, ooh, ooh. All the flair's gonna lay, 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 lay. And the fondant makes it fake, 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 fake. Baby, I'm just gonna cake, 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 cake. I'll cake it off, I'll cake it off, yum, yum, yum. Okay, so.
Oh, shit.
Okay, so here's how this works. We have 4 clues. They start off more obscure, and they get increasingly obvious.
Okay.
And you also have 2 lifelines. You have Ask Emma, so you can ask Emma for her thoughts. And you also have the frosting reveal. I will tell you what the frosting is. So use
this is
those.
Very much like pie in this guy, but with cake.
Yeah, this is pie in this guy with cake. We've done this before.
Yeah.
Pie in this guy, colon, cake it off.
Okay.
However you want to think about it. It's a spin-off segment with a different song, and it's about cake instead of pie.
The Guisados guys have so much bullshit to get through.
I hope if
and
anyone
then at the
from...
end, after the fork score, then they get cake it off.
Look, they've stopped listening a while ago, but if you work for Guisados, if you're all involved in that, first off, thank you for your service, and I hope we did your restaurant justice, because it really is great food that we
have. Yeah.
All right, so here's how Cake It Off works.
now back to the shit.
So, the clues get increasingly obvious. So they start off the most obscure, most challenging, and then you have 2 lifelines you can invoke at any time. Lamar, you are a guest. You can go first or second. It's up to you.
I'll go first.
Okay, you'll go first.
The lifeline is like I get to ask just another clue from them.
The lifelines are you can either you just choose to use a lifeline and mm-hmm. you can choose whether you want to ask Emma or if you want me to tell you what the frosting is.
Okay, gotcha.
And just to talk about this real quick, like to talk about a pie in the sky slash cake it off holistically. Mitch, you started off when we first started doing this segment. You started off with a record of 1-7. You did very poorly versus our guests for a while. However, you have been roaring back, and you have beaten your way up to climbed your way up to an 8-10 record.
Wow!
So you were on a little bit of a heater. You were 6-3 in your last 9 outings.
Wow!
So there you go. So we'll see if you can get up to 500 and perhaps a winning record.
Been filled with piss and vinegar. I'm putting in the effort now. It
seems like. All right, Lamar, you've gone first, and remember you have 2 lifelines.
Okay. All right,
first clue. The first known recipe for this cake was published in 1814 by King Louis XVI's former chef?
Okay. So just guess the cake?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then guess the cake. Yeah, sorry. Okay. Key detail,
I
should
have said. What do you want from me? King Louis, so that's like the old days.
Yeah, 1814, King Louis XVI, his former chef.
Is it like a bun cake?
No, it's not bundt cake. Okay. All right, Mitch, you're up. And remember, two lifelines are available.
Okay.
Next clue. World War II rationing led to an increase in popularity of this cake's commonly available chief ingredient.
I have the answer.
Already?
Carrot cake.
Oh, my God.
Mitch, you have won Cake It Off. Whoa. I can't believe it.
How the fuck did you do that?
Hold on. What was the question?
Here is your slice of carrot cake.
No carrot cake. That's a little
good. I'm gonna gift our guest the cake because that's the type of man I am.
I deserved it. Well, it's from Gelson's. All right. Thanks, bro.
Can I have a bite of it?
Yeah.
All right.
The clue was World War II rationing led to an increase in popularity of this cake's commonly available chief ingredient. Did that tip you off?
And also, I was just like, carrot cake seems like something that is from the 1800s.
Yeah. You were correct, yeah. Next one was going to be about this fall favorite includes cinnamon cloves, ginger, and nutmeg. And then the final clue, what's up, Doc? To enthusiasts, this cake shines like a valuable diamond.
I would have got it right there.
Yeah.
I would have got it. Yeah, good job, man.
Wow, 9 and 10.
9 and 10.
We've done this 19 times.
Just like a restaurant about your feedback, let's open the feedback. And today we have an email from Jennifer from Ohio, a.k.a. Totoro in the Doscord.
Mm.
Jennifer writes, all right, here we go. Here's the question. If you had to teach a college-level class about a subject other than the one you actually studied or are employed in, what subject do you think you could teach?
Mm.
That's a question.
Well, I can't.
Yeah, because if it's something like there's stuff that I like. Yeah, if it's something I've studied, that would be the only thing I'd be at all qualified to teach. So there's basically this
we
is
can't
like
teach anything in entertainment.
I guess not.
Then nothing. I'm useless.
Well, okay. So my answer, I think, is both everything and nothing. Because I think one of the things I'm best at is bullshitting. Like, I'm really good at, like, just sort of talking with confidence about something I don't really know about. And I can just, like, kind of talk fluidly enough where people are like, okay, this guy must know what he's saying. So I think I could probably, like, with a modicum of research, kind of bullshit my way through teaching a course on anything. But I would not be qualified to do anything. I would not be qualified. I would not be actually giving people useful information.
That's
so,
a great answer.
I think I could do the stars one. The space, like astronomy. Yeah, I think I can do that.
Yeah,
and like get away. I don't know. I mean, I feel like I see shit, or we just what I see.
Yeah. I mean, I think you're calling it the stars one is probably not.
I do the stars 101. It's stars one 101. We don't get it. What do you think?
I feel like this is like a good. I should be like a gym teacher. I mean, I wouldn't be good. I mean, I'm not in shape, but I think it would be
fun. You don't have to be in shape.
Hey, you do jumping jacks. I think I could do that. But this is like a professor, right?
You could teach college level PE.
Yeah, sure. I could maybe do that.
Yeah, I guess. Or like health or whatever.
Yeah, they must, yeah.
It makes me feel like such a fucking... Look, maybe I could teach some sort of math class. I'd be learning it as I was teaching it.
But you are good at math.
I was good at math.
You're sneaky good at math.
So I could maybe do something like that. I mean, I couldn't. That's an insult to every math
professor. That's what the challenge about this, because you're saying college level class.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, my dad taught in college. So he's a chemistry professor. And like, that's like, you have to have a fucking PhD or whatever. Like you have to have, you know, you have to have a lot of accumulated knowledge, a lot of expertise.
I feel like sadly it would be like pop culture class. And I don't even know that. I have no idea what's going on in current pop culture. But maybe like TV. But that's also, we work in entertainment. So that feels entertainment. Look, I think that we should go the route. We should go dirty again. Like Quick Comes 101.
This is how it happens. You just watch your brain like shrink. I can't think of anything. So what I can do is talk about my semen. So the I wanted to be a professor.
Did you really?
Really?
Because I wanted to teach religion. I got my degree in religious studies. So
yes,
I
was going to go. But you can do that, right?
No, she's saying you can't do it, or you can't do what you studied.
Already. Right. Nothing you studied or employed. So
I would love to do that.
That's
but
like impossible. If you can't do what you studied. I was like a sociology major at one point, and I actually couldn't even do it because I wouldn't know.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'm saying, like, that's like, it's like even the things that you study sometimes is hard to.
I guess, yeah, it's been years since I actually studied that stuff. So yeah. I don't know if I could go out and, like, just teach it without going back to school.
Right. So you'd need a refresher at least. But wait, can we talk about this? Can we take a little tangent? Because this was a fascinating discussion when we were having lunch because you studied theology, you studied religious studies in college.
Oh, yeah, we were talking about that.
And you were like, you're really into, like, religion, like, not just like, you know, like not necessarily like that you're like a hyper religious person, but that you're like the idea of it, like conceptually and like the history of it.
Yeah, I like it, like the way people like sports or
right.
Like I follow the team, like I follow like different trends or like what religious, like I notice, you know, I notice when a religion is becoming more popular. I like looking at the numbers. It's like really cool. And I just like, and I call it, they call it like in Wiccan, they have this word where they say you have like an enchanted worldview.
Mm.
That's how I feel. Like, I feel like I'm walking through the world enchanted. Like, I'm just like, I'll believe anything. Anything you tell me, I'll believe it. Like,
yeah.
But it's like, I don't know. I think there's a lot of people going to study religion. They end up, and I did, this has happened to me where I did lose faith completely. And I was like, oh, all this shit is bullshit. But then after I finished it, then I got reinterested in it.
Right.
And like, it's a little easier to become like fully atheist out of that, but because you just know too much or something. But now I'm like, I'm just into it. Like, oh, what's this religion? I went to one, when I moved to LA, I was doing all types of shit, doing some chant. Like, we went to this chanting room one time and we were just chanting the whole time. It was awesome. Like,
I want to be able to do the response that well in that room. So,
yeah, call us by. You'd be fucking up. Like, when I say fair, you say contract. But that, I was like, why are they talking about this in here? It was crazy.
You know what? I was about to say you should listen to a couple old episodes of Doughboys, but in reality, I don't mean that, and you shouldn't, and it would suck. But we did a religious month.
We did we did.
October blessed.
Yeah, that was, and I will say, like, we went to a meditation sort of like workshop as part of that. We also, like, you and I each went to church. Like, I went to an Episcopalian church.
Great.
I was Episcopalian. I like chilling in church. I was
y'all
like, hey,
do that again. Let me do it with y'all. I like to shop. I like to go anywhere.
And a thing that we didn't say in the episode title, and now maybe have we ever talked about it on a main episode? Probably. We went to a Scientology brunch.
Yes, we did. Yeah, we have talked about that. Yeah, that was wild. Wait, have you, like, okay, so here's the thing that you run into, and, like, basically every religion has some sort of, like, food restrictions. Mm-hmm. There's some, like, you know, some have, like, an alcohol ban, others have, like, you know, like, a pork ban or a shellfish ban or whatever.
Right, right.
Are there any commonalities there? Is that, like, a thing, like, is that, have you noticed anything that applies, like, across a bunch of different religions?
Yeah.
Is it tied to the region of the religion or anything? Is there anything you found?
Absolutely. Yeah. There's, like, a whole study on it. I don't want to miss... say it's incorrect. Sure. Like, I just don't remember too well, but there's a really good book. I'll see if I can find it, about Leviticus and about all the restrictions of like food and stuff, and like how it like how we sort of like categorize certain animals and stuff like that. Like, one example is like locomotion. Like, the idea of an animal with like weird, strange locomotion is just like, we won't eat it. Like a snake, for example,
right?
Like, or a bug. But like, these become like ingrained in religion, and they're like, you know, they become, have some religious significance, but it's actually just like our human nature can't like understand like what it is, so we just don't eat it. But it, like, there's a bunch of like there, like the pork is obviously a big one that's just seems to go like translate over a lot of religions. But I think that's the only one I know for sure is like a big, like, seems to be everywhere, the pork one. But I don't know. I don't want to get to it because I don't want to offend anybody if I say the wrong thing. But there is definitely like some real shit there. There's definitely something going on there. Like, there's something with, it's just a thing about eating and religion that's like even barbecue. I took a class on barbecue, like the religious significance on it, because it happens on Sunday, you know, in the South and stuff. And it's such like a, there's some like the ritual nature of it. It's like there's some level of worship, but there's like this sacrifice of like the meat and stuff. Anyway. We can get into. I can talk about that all. I'm gonna do my own podcast. Yeah, we're gonna do another one about that.
I love that. Yeah.
Have you ever eaten snake? I've eaten snake before.
I have. I think I have.
I think I've eaten snake, but I can't remember it specifically. I've eaten gator.
I've had alligator. Yeah, I've had.
I've had gator. I've had snake too.
I've had snake. Yeah. What kind of snake?
Are you getting mad at me because I'm like gonna make some sort of joke about him suck his own dick?
Oh, okay.
All right. Yeah.
Man, I was all sincere and shit. Man, I thought I was gonna talk about snake for a second.
I gotta get the Guisados people to stop listening. That's what I'm trying to do.
I can't remember when I had snake.
I gator. I had gator.
I think
down
maybe
a
snake is a sausage or something. Yeah. Does that sound right?
That's a common way they make it.
Yeah.
Seems like an easy one to one, right?
snake dog. Yeah.
That's a tough question.
That's a tough question. I think, if I'm trying to answer this sincerely, because I can't really say, I can't really say anything I'm knowledgeable about because that's all stuff that I either studied or I worked in.
Right.
So it's like, that's fucking tricky.
I feel like you could give, I'm being sincere. I feel like you could give like a Columbine seminar if you want.
Jesus. Actually, you do know a lot
book.
About, I
That's
do know a lot
I'm
about
saying.
Columbine. I could actually talk about
That's
that.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Okay. I feel like you could do like a good American tragedies.
Yeah, I could probably, actually, honestly, I could, not that I'm a super true crime guy, but specifically like I've read a lot about like mass shootings and like those traumatic events. So I probably could talk about those at length. I could talk about basketball.
Jesus Christ. Imagine signing up for your class.
That would be an interesting
and then
class,
seeing the professor
though,
the first day.
History
like,
of mass
what
shootings.
The fuck?
Hi, I'm Weiger.
this is what he looks like. That would be fun. I mean, not fun, but that would be a really cool class.
That would be
interesting class.
It seems like it was worth studying and talking about.
Yeah. And then I was trying to think of what else. It was like...
The real answer is that we're useless.
The real answer is that we're useless. We don't have any actual skills. I feel like there was one other thing I felt like I could kind of talk about.
And it's like embarrassing when my mom asked me to like drill something. I'm like, I don't know how. Like that's
truth. Oh my God. Talking about my dad again. That was like, he was such a good carpenter and could like, he still does. He still like construct, like build shit. And like, is always showing me how to do things when I was a kid. I was like I didn't play video games. Mm-hmm. And then I become an adult. It's like all those skills would be so useful if I knew how to like fucking do absolutely anything. And I'm totally useless in that regard.
My mom's like, I'm going to hang this poster for you. I'm like, I don't know how to do it. I'm 40.
Yeah.
It's pathetic.
No, I have to say, I was at the bar last night, and this guy sitting next to me was giving me such a hard time because I told him my TaskRabbit, my TV stand. Yeah. I had somebody come and do it for me, and he's like, what's wrong with you, man? You can't do this. You got to do it yourself. And I'm like, I'm like, bro, I don't even know you. Like, get on my face. Like, don't talk to me.
First of all, this guy needs to relax.
Yeah.
Like, mounting your TV is so – I had someone mount my TV, and, like, it isn't right. You know, it's like – that is, like, a genuinely hard thing to do.
Yeah.
That's not easy.
Yeah, I know. It's a pain in the ass. Anyway – yeah, we can't teach anything. Sorry. Sorry, Jennifer.
The real question is, what would you do if you could do anything in the world? It's like a more complicated version of that.
Right, yeah.
The real question is like, why are you doing this to us? You're just,
come on,
you're making
you
us
doing?
Look like shit. We look
you
like assholes.
You look like fucking idiots? You succeeded.
You succeeded.
Good job. It wasn't hard.
Yeah.
We're kind of doing it ourselves.
Yeah, the episode
earlier.
Itself was easy.
We started off by saying this is going
to
be a piss episode, so... anyway, if you have a question or comment about the world of chain restaurants, you can email us at doughboyspodcast@gmail.com or leave us a voicemail, 830-GO-DO. That's 830-463-6844. And get the Doughboys Double, our weekly bonus episode, by joining the Golden or Platinum Plate Club at patreon.com/doughboys.
I think we're piss and vinegared out.
I think so. I think we're on fumes at this point. Lamar Woods, thank you so much for joining us. What a treat.
Thanks for having me. I'm so excited I got to see the six forks. Like, that's crazy. Like, and I'm glad I got to be a part of that. I'm so glad I pulled up on y'all. I did not know y'all was going to be there. I was just like, let me just get this shit real quick. and y'all were there. It was
timed
crazy.
Out perfectly.
We get this bullshit over with for this stupid podcast I have to do.
I was stressed out. I was like, fuck it.
I think I wanted a platinum score for it, but four is a great score. And also, if you went six, it's very scary. So I'm happy that it wasn't.
Oh, yeah. Jesus. Fucking...
The devil's number.
Yeah, instead of the Manhattan zip code, it's fucking Satan's neck of the woods.
No,
talk about a fucking scary religion.
But I'm definitely going back. I'm definitely going to, like, if the next time I come on here, I'll let you know how I feel later. But
I love that.
I love it.
Anything you'd like to plug?
Just the Gossip Kings. You got it. It's on the same network, HeadGum.
That's right.
We're in season 5 right now, me and Carl Tart. We release every Friday, and it's a great time. If you like Gossip Girl, then you'll love this show because we are two black men who are very sincerely interested in it. And, but if you don't like Gossip Girl or don't know anything about it, we also don't really talk about the show at all. So you get best of both worlds. Just pull up on us. Also, I perform with my group, The Big Team, the second Friday of every month at UCB Theater. So pull up on us there.
Yeah. If you're in LA, check that out. Check out Guisados.
Such a funny dude.
One of the best.
One of the best.
One of our faves.
I love y'all, man.
Love you too, buddy. Love you too. That'll do it for this episode of Doughboys. Till next time, for the Spoon Man, Mike Mitchell, I'm Nick Weiger. Happy eating.
You're giving me
Wow, you gave him the cake.
Yeah, I can't take it. I mean, you went it fair and square. I did, like.
Wow.
Let's all eat it together.
Okay, yeah.
Bye. Want to dress like the Doughboys? Of course you don't. But you will want to wear our all-new Doughboys merch. Check out our completely revamped merch line in partnership with Kinship Goods. We've got high-quality shirts, hats, aprons, totes, and much more to come. Wow! Only at doughboys.kinshipgoods.com. That's KINSHIP goods.com. Sources for the intro are in the episode description.
That was a HeadGum Podcast.